Well, welcome everybody to today's Council on Foreign Relations meeting with a conversation with Bank of France Governor Villeroy. I'm Paul Sheard. I'm a senior fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School's Mossavar-Rahmani Center for Business and Government. And it's a pleasure to be here. I think Governor Villeroy is well known to everybody. He assumed the position of the Governor of the Bank of France on 1st of November 2015. Prior to that, he held senior management executive positions at BNP Paribas since about 2003, and before that had a very illustrious career at the French Treasury. So we're delighted to have him here with us this morning at this opportunity. So let me lead off, Governor, and again, welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations, with perhaps you could share some thoughts on the what you see as the outlook for the Eurozone economy at the moment. How's it going? Seems to have flagged a little bit, but how do you see it?
First, good morning to everybody, and let me say how pleased and honored I am to be the guest of this Council on Foreign Relations. To go to your questions, allow me first a long-term view, because the Eurozone just celebrated its 20th anniversary. You are conscious that Euro economically was introduced in January 99. And so I circulated some slides. I don't know if you have them, but just to comment on the long-term view, go to slide number six, this one, which is maybe a bit surprising to you. We compare the long-term growth and employment performance of the Eurozone versus the US. And it's not that different. If you look at the yearly growth of GDP per capita, 1% in the Eurozone, 1.2 in the US, and the difference focuses on 2 years, 2012 and 2013, where we had a specific Eurozone crisis. And if you look at the employment increase, it's very parallel in both economies, with a significant job creation, 10 million in the Eurozone since 2013. So the long-term view, including the recent years, is quite favorable. We still had a growth of 2.5% in 2017 and 1.8% last year. But, and Paul, this is your point, we have a slowdown this year. Let me say some words about the forecast. Our forecast, ECB forecast, is 1.1% for this year. We just published this morning the professional forecast, senior economist, 1.2%, and the IMF is slightly more optimistic with 1.3. But everybody expects a slowdown, and everybody expects an improvement next year, so with a recovery around the second half of this year. We'll see exactly the figures. One important point about the Governing Council we had yesterday, it was a Governing Council without new forecast. You are probably aware that we published new forecasts each quarter, so it was March and it will be June. But we should probably look at the Eurozone and the average figures I just quoted in a more differentiated way, and obviously the situation is quite different today between the four major European economies, Germany and Italy on one side, and France and Spain on the other side. But a last comment about the Eurozone as a whole, it's a slowdown. It's not a recession. Mario Draghi repeated yesterday that the probability of a recession remains very low, and we shared this analysis yesterday. So we will probably come to our monetary policy stance. We didn't change it, but we said very clearly that we are determined to be as accommodative as needed for as long as necessary to reach our inflation target.
Great, thank you. France, of course, is the second largest economy in the Eurozone, and you're the Bank of France governor. Could you give us a little bit of your insight into the French economy in particular, and you sort of categorized it there with Spain vis-a-vis okay. Germany and Italy, but perhaps a little bit on the French economy.
No, it's a good opportunity to differentiate a bit, as I said. As you know, the four major economies in the Eurozone, Germany, France, Italy, and Spain, together are about three quarters of the GDP, so it's significant. And we have a quite different picture today between Italy, which is more or less a 0% growth, and they had even a technical recession at the end of last year for all the reasons we know. Germany, which is a question mark, and with the most significant slowdown due to idiosyncratic factors. We all heard about the new automotive test, about the low level of the Rhine last summer. It's the first economic effect of climate change, by the way. But also, and probably most importantly, external factors with the slowdown of world trade, mainly focused on Asia. And this is, by the way, the most impressive economic phenomenon we see at present. When you look at the evolution of world trade in manufacturing, it's a very significant slowdown in the second half of last year, and with even a stagnation or a slight recession in January, the last figure we have. This affects more than others the German economy. If I come to France, it's more resilient. We had a growth last year of 1.6%, and we expect a growth this year of 1.4%. So it's a very limited slowdown due to two elements. First is the fact that the French economy is less exposed to Asian trade and Asian exports, which might be a drawback in brilliant years, but which is a protection in such years. And the second reason is that internal demand is very resilient. Again, going very quickly through my slides, go perhaps to slide 2, which is a very simple comparison of the expected growth for the G7 economies this year. Obviously, the US economy is ahead, but you see that France is a very close third to Canada, and that Japan, Germany, and Italy are lagging behind. So the French resilience, as well as the Spanish resilience, which is expected at around 2%, will help to protect Eurozone growth. If I focus one last minute on the strength of internal demand, if you come to slide 3, and I will have come for in this very quick manner, thanks to you, through most of my slides in 10 minutes. You see that purchasing power, this one, is expected at around 2% growth per capita this year, which is the strongest growth in the last 12 years, and it will help domestic consumption. The key question probably is what will be the savings rate. We expect it to increase a bit, but then to stabilize, and it will help. It will help domestic growth. One last comment about the reasons for this very strong purchasing power, which can seem as a paradox because you probably followed with interest this Gilets Jaunes move we had at the end of last year, this yellow vest, which was focused on le pouvoir d'achat, as we say in French, purchasing power. And it's not an unusual paradox that such a request comes stronger when economic news are already better. And there are also distributional aspects in this debate. I always quote average, so I don't say that everybody has such an increase of its purchasing power. But the drivers of this increase are threefold. First, very strong job creations in the last 3 years. Between 16 and 18, the French economy created almost 800,000 jobs, which was an unprecedented performance. Second, now wage increase, and this is a general trend we see in the Eurozone, which is a favorable factor, and a key question will be how this wage increase, linked to the improvement of the employment situation, will pass through to core inflation. We could perhaps discuss this issue later. And a third driver, French-specific, is a fiscal package decided by President Macron after this yellow vest move last December of around 0.4% of GDP. And let me stress, if I am allowed to have one off-the-record demand, as an independent central banker, I'm not expected to welcome a fiscal package, especially in a country with a rather significant level of public debt. But if I look at the economic content of this package, it was rather well designed. The main measure was an increase of what we call activity premium, To put it in American terms, it's exactly an earned income tax credit. So for working poor and to encourage people to get new jobs or to work more, so it made economic sense. It was not an increase of the minimum wage, and this is very important. So all these elements combined help the resilience of the French economy.
Thank you very much for that overview. So you mentioned the Governing Council meeting yesterday, and I understand you came directly from that.
Yes, no, Frankfurt, Washington.
No rest for the wicked here.
Frankfurt Council on Foreign Relations, directly.
Exactly. Now, obviously, no changes to policy yesterday, but you did make an adjustment in your forward guidance around the earliest point at which you could adjust interest rates, presumably.
But this was last March. This was not yesterday.
No, in March. So yeah. You didn't change yesterday, but you made that adjustment in forward guidance in March. But anything sort of hot off the presses that came out of the Governing Council? Certainly one thing that caught some people's eye, and this may not be new news, I'm not sure, but the reference to looking at the mitigating potential side effects of negative interest rates on bank intermediation and how that might potentially come to fruition.
Perhaps three quick comments, but as you said, it was not a council for decision. First, we confirmed our monetary commitment, and this is very strong, that we are ready to be accommodative for as much and as long as necessary to reach our inflation target. And it's very important to have a very clear determination in such uncertain times. Second, that in the framework of our regular assessment, as we said, we will assess the effects of negative rates and the possible need for mitigating measures, but let us now work and then decide. It will be a technical discussion. And third, if I can add, in the situation we are in, it's true in the euro area, it's true elsewhere, monetary policy cannot be the only game in town. And it's also important that it's not up to us central bankers, but it will be an important discussion here in Washington in the coming days, that we discuss also about the other economic policy measures we should implement at national or at coordinated level to face the present slowdown, especially if it should last a bit longer than expected.
Thank you. One area that is often talked about, and maybe we'll get some questions on this, in the context of the Eurozone is the banking system, and particularly concerns about, still I think Italy probably is top of that list, but even other larger economies that may have exposure to banking system issues. Could you say a little bit about your assessment of the strength or otherwise of the banking system in the Eurozone? And how much of a concern is it, and how much of a risk factor do you see?
No, I will not comment about any specific bank, but let us look at the picture as a whole. And if you look at the health of the banking system, we should probably look at two figures. First is the level of capital, and second is the level of profit, return on equity. If you look at the level of capital, it has been significantly increased in the Eurozone, as it has been in the US and in other jurisdictions. And so this is very important to be aware of, because Main Street sometimes thinks that it's business as usual, back to the pre-crisis level. No, it's not. And as a whole, banks doubled the level of equity in the last 10 years, let's say, as a result of the regulatory requirements introduced in a cooperative manner. It's very important that we stick to that. The cost of the financial crisis has been very high in this country, in Europe, elsewhere, and so banks are now safer, and that we implement till the end this international regulation, including Basel III. So it means, take it as a magnitude for the European banks, a level of capital, core tier one, around 14% today. If I now come to profitability, return on equity is about 7%. It's close, a bit higher than the level for the British banking system. It's close to the level of the Japanese banking system. It's, in the most recent period last year, a bit lower than in the US. Again, these are averages. And obviously, the economic situation in the US is more favorable. The level of the interest rates is higher. So it's why we can explain this difference. It doesn't mean that we are at the end of the road. Again, the figures are not so bad, and not as bad as I sometimes read it. They are much better for the level of capital. They have improved for the return of equity, but it's not the end of the road. Nobody should expect, probably, return on equity to come back to the pre-crisis level. If you double the level of equity, it's normal that return on equity is smaller. But it's not the end of the road. And most European banks are engaged in a very significant transformation task, including digitalization. And digitalization is obviously not only for fintechs or new entrants, it's mainly for incumbents, which means very significant investment. Second, diversification of revenues. If I look at French banks, they are probably among the most diversified. When you are in an environment of low rates, it's better to have higher fees and, to give an example, bank insurance. So they sell insurance products, and this kind of diversification is very positive in my eyes. And the last element is consolidation. And this is more specific probably to the European landscape. Consolidation is much more advanced in this country here in the US. It could mean domestic consolidation. I will not comment on any specific example in one important European economy you could think of. But it also means, and probably still more, cross-border consolidation, which would have the benefit of size, scale, as domestic consolidation, but also the benefits of strengthening the banking union and the cross-border allocation, better allocation of private savings. And this is what we need, clearly. To give you a last figure, perhaps, if I look at the four, five most important American banks, commercial banks, they have a market share in the US after the consolidation move of the last 10 years of a bit more than 40%. If I look at the five most important European banks in the Eurozone, they have a market share of about 20%. So there is room for improvement.
You mentioned
while preserving competition, obviously.
You mentioned the banking union there, and obviously that's been one of the major sort of institutional developments in the last few years coming out of the sovereign debt crisis and, you know, the whole question of how to complete the economic and monetary union. That's fairly well advanced. There's still the deposit insurance piece, which is still sort of outstanding. But capital markets union is another major theme, and I think you've been talking recently more generally about financing market or financial union more generally. You know, any quick thoughts about how that whole agenda is playing out? What are the key stumbling blocks? What is the outlook for progress there?
This is a very important question, Paul, if I can elaborate 3 minutes. First, I published last week with my German friend and colleague, Jens Weidmann, president of the Bundesbank, a joint paper on this capital markets union and more broadly what we call together a financing union for investment and innovation. My favorite slide, it might be the last one, slide 8, if you can take it. And let me elaborate somewhat, because this is very important about the strengthening of the economic union. I said earlier that monetary policy should not be the only game in town. Some of you might probably remember that at the start of the euro, the project was called Economic and Monetary Union. If I look at the track record for the last 20 years, monetary union is a success without any doubt. It delivered its promise of price stability, it delivered growth and employment, I show you the chart, and most importantly, it has a very strong popular support. You will see some figures, 75% of euro citizens want to keep the euro, 81% in Germany. This is probably the most important figure. It's sometimes underestimated outside of Europe, but there is a very strong political support for the euro, which explains some political decisions in the past, including in Germany. But economic union, beside monetary union, is still to be achieved, to say the least. And we had many discussions, as you know, about that in the last year. There is a public part of the discussion. We might perhaps come to it about a Eurozone fiscal capacity or strengthening the European Stability Mechanism, the ESM. It's important, but there is a private part of the discussion which is less often mentioned and which for me is at least as important. And this is what this slide is about. What is the idea that we should add banking union and capital market union to better use the abundant savings we have in Europe and to allocate it better through the borders to our investment needs? So you see on the left, these are our saving resources. And as the Eurozone has an external surplus, it has a surplus of savings towards investment of 340 billion euro last year. But we have significant investment needs. Think of digitalization, think of green transition, and think of SME scaling up. Corporate equity is unfortunately less developed in the euro area than it is in the US. To give you again average, corporate equity to GDP is 80% in the euro area and more than 120% in the US. This is very important as we are in an innovative economy. We all know that you finance innovation better through equities than through debt. So to develop equity would be a very strong purpose of such a financing union. We shouldn't oppose banking union and capital markets. And there is sometimes this presentation saying European, the European economy should become American and substitute bank channel through the capital market standard. Partly yes, but this is not for me the bulk of the story. We should add the two channels. And if I focus on the banking union, we made decisive progress on what we call the first pillar, supervision. It's operational. We have now fully centralized supervision for the 130 most important European banks. But we still have to complete the two following pillars. I don't know if you remember, the second pillar is resolution, so how we deal with banks in trouble. And the third pillar is what you mentioned about deposit insurance. My personal view is very strongly that there is a logical order. We started with the third pillar, supervision. We should now complete as a priority the second pillar, resolution. It's more technical. It's less often mentioned than the deposit insurance, because if you allow me, everybody understands when you speak about common deposit insurance. When you speak about resolution, it's difficult to speak to public opinion in a simple way. But it's more important. We made progress in the last December package, but we are not yet there. And I would say that the third pillar could come at a later stage. We know that it's politically very contentious, and it's probably economically slightly less important. Let me stress this change of priority. So, two accent to conclude with. Public mechanisms are important, but private ones are at least as important and probably less politically difficult. It's why I advocate such a financing union. And within the banking union, the second pillar is more important than the third one at present.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Not to end too much on this part of the conversation on a sort of a negative note, but there's a lot of discussion, we hear them at these meetings and elsewhere, about what sort of policy ammunition will central banks and fiscal authorities have, you know, in the next downturn, you know, if it comes or should it come. Obviously, you've still got negative interest rate policy, you've, if anything, sort of extended your monetary accommodation. But in terms of, thinking about that issue and planning for the worst, what would your message be around the kind of tools that the ECB in particular would have to deal with another serious downturn? And you mentioned before fiscal policy, and it's always a little bit of a sometimes an embarrassment between fiscal and monetary policy. Everybody kind of agrees fiscal policy should be doing something a little bit different, but half the people think it should be consolidation, half the people think it should be expansion. But if you sort of think about the next downturn, should it come, how do you see the toolkit that you have, and how would you see the scope potentially for more monetary and fiscal coordination, cooperation in the Eurozone in particular?
It's a wide-ranging question.
Yes, I'm
question.
Sorry, I mean...
No, we'll probably come back to the question, fiscal versus monetary. I would add also structural reforms, which are an important part of the answer. But obviously, fiscal policy should be differentiated depending on the present situation of public finance. It's also true within the Eurozone. But can I focus on monetary policy? First, to remind you that this is not our central scenario at present. So it's too early to tell what we would do, but let me express a very simple conviction. We are not short of ammunition, and we are ready to use all our options whenever necessary. It's our mandate. We did it in the past. We could do it in the future. Probably the most telling answer to your question is to deal with this question of Japanization, which sometimes come as a fashionable picture, a fashionable word, but it's fashionable. I don't think it's accurate. And could I elaborate somewhat about that? The Eurozone is not in a situation of Japanization. We could also discuss whether Japan is in a situation of Japanization as incorporated in this concept. But let me focus on the Eurozone. It's a quite different situation if I look at it economically and even financially and from a monetary point of view. If I look at the Eurozone economy, and if you look at nominal GDP growth last year, 3.3% in the Eurozone, 0.7% in Japan. And this is very important, nominal GDP, because you have to compare it with the level of nominal interest rates, and you see that there is much more room for maneuver. If I look at inflation expectations, they are around 1.5%, slightly below in the most recent week in the euro area, a bit above 0% in Japan. And if I come to give you two last figures to the financial and monetary part of the story, level of debt, I mean public debt plus private debt from households and non-financial companies, it's 360% to GDP for Japan, 205% for the euro. A significant difference, be it on public debt or on private debt. And if I look at the size of the central bank balance sheet, 100% of GDP for Japan, 40% for the euro area. So it's part of the answer to your question about our level of ammunition.
Great, thank you very much. So at this point, I would like to open the whole meeting to our members and just remind you that when you ask a question, if you could just ask one question, state your name and affiliation, be quite concise, and if you could just put your tent card in a vertical position, I can collect the questions.
And we could perhaps say some words during the round about Brexit, which was supposed to be the theme of
right.
the day.
So let me, give people...
Due to the good news of yesterday, we shouldn't forget.
Give people a chance to gather their thoughts and put their tent cards up. Let me take that opportunity and just ask you very quickly about Brexit, unless Eric was going to do so. But obviously that was the big news yesterday. But can I ask you a very specific... You can talk about this more in the Q&A, but a very... kind of rather specific, more central bank watchers question, which I haven't heard asked. Of course, we have the ECB, we have the Euro system, and we have the European system of central banks. Mm-hmm. And the Bank of England is a member of the European system of central banks. And much of the treaty, when it talks about monetary policy, actually refers to the European system of central banks, because, of course, the euro is the currency of the European Union. Are there any implications whatsoever of the Bank of England leaving the European system of central banks for the system, for monetary policy? You'll obviously lose some colleagues, but is there anything that we don't sort of know about that is going on at that level that, you know, from the central banker's point of view, is a little bit of a loss?
Let me first say that as a personal comment, but I think we will all share it, the timetable agreed yesterday evening in Brussels is good news, because it gives us collectively 6 months more to avoid the worst solution, which is a no-deal Brexit. And this is clearly the will of the majority of British people and British MPs. It's good news. It's not yet the solution, because it's now up to our British friends to decide within this 6 months which kind of deal they want to avoid a no-deal Brexit. But it's good news. To answer to your specific question, and Paul, if I may congratulate you, because not many people are aware of the situation you described, we have a subscribed capital of the ECB with 28 central bank shareholders, and not the 19 members of the Eurozone. So if I look at the subscribed capital, Bank of England is a significant shareholder with around 40% of ECB theoretical capital, if you want. Subscribed capital, I guess is the right word, but it's on paper, so to say. If I look to the paid up capital, there is a very significant difference between the Eurozone member and the EU non-Euro members. So the paid-up capital detained by the Bank of England is much, much smaller, zero point something. So its participation in the benefits and the possible losses of the ECB is much, much smaller too. So if they leave, we will have a new repartition of the subscribed capital and of the paid-up capital, but as you see on the real capital, it's not a huge story. From an institutional point of view, we have a governing council which gathers each second week, and we have a not very well-known body, which is the so-called general council, which meets each quarter with the 28. And my colleague, I was about to say my British colleague, but as you know, he is Canadian, Mark Carney, friend, comes very regularly to the General Council. We really appreciate. So unfortunately, the Bank of England will leave the General Council. We'll leave also some technical committees they are part of in such a wide formation. It will not make a huge difference for our technical decision, because most technical decisions, as you can imagine, are taken within the 19. And fortunately, we will have other bodies and other opportunities to meet, to mention only two, the Washington meetings and the Basel meetings we have each second month between central bank governors. But it's very important that we cooperate together. We did it, which is not very well known. We did it in the most recent period. There was a technical workshop between ECB and Bank of England to prevent all the technical accidents we could have had in Brexit. We did excellent work together, and it's our intention to go on.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you. So, Eric, your question.
Great. Thank you. Eric Stein from Eaton Vance. Question, you got into this a little bit on the negative implications of negative rates. Can you give us any more thoughts, whether it's on tiering of bank deposits, which has been discussed, or also, you know, do you have thoughts on the yield curve? Does the yield curve matter and for banks in particular, not just as a signal? Is there things that you could do to potentially steepen the curve and help the banking transmission mechanism from a monetary policy perspective?
I'm sorry I will disappoint you somewhat, but it will not be a huge surprise for you. I will not add anything to what Mario Draghi said yesterday. We had a consensus yesterday to, within the framework of our regular assessment, to analyze the effects of negative interest rates on bank intermediation. We all believe that the overall effect of negative interest rates is positive, but we will assess if there are any side effects, and if so, if mitigation measures are needed. But let us work and then decide. I think it's a good method. But I cannot give you the result before working on it.
Thank you very much. I can't quite see the name. Is it David?
David Bard, the Halifax Group in the University of Pennsylvania. It's a little bit outside your wheelhouse, but I just wanted to get your perspective on what's going on with tariffs around the world, not least of which is yesterday's back and forth with your continent and ours, and how you think about the specific leaders involved and how that might play out.
Could you precise a bit your question about specific leaders?
There may be a cast of characters involved, and sometimes personalities drive outcomes more than policy intends. And the extent to which you think idiosyncrasies of people involved might affect the outcome, I'd love to hear that.
If you allow me, I am a modest central banker. I'm not in charge of trade negotiations or of psychology of political leaders. Fortunately so, they are democratically elected, so I will not make any comment of that. But about your general question, obviously, trade uncertainties played a major role in the slowdown we spoke about, a major role. And let me insist a bit on that, because there is sometimes a view that when you don't have the increase in tariffs, you don't have negative effects. So you can negotiate, you can speak, for years without having negative effects on growth, provided you don't increase the tariffs. This would be wrong. The negative uncertainty induced by trade tensions started with the uncertainty itself. And one very striking example is Brexit. You have no tariffs between till today. Zero tariff between the British economy and the EU 27. And despite that, we all know that there has been a significant slowdown effect on the British economy due to this uncertainty, especially on business investment. So probably the main channel, the first channel in time of trade tensions to the slowdown goes through business confidence and then diminution of business investment, and then slower growth. You could see a second channel, which is risk premium on financial markets. But this first channel, through business confidence and business investment, is probably the most powerful one. And the level, it has been documented, there are interested figures, as a matter of fact, in the last World Economic Outlook published by the IMF this week. But the level of business investment in the UK is significantly lower than what it would have been without these Brexit fears. We have mutatis mutandis, the same effect at world level. And if you look at the evolution of world trade I mentioned, the diminution in manufacturing is especially impressive, and the diminution in capital goods is especially impressive. It's the same investment effect. So we should look at it a bit more closely, but what I just said about this main negative effect is also probably the main positive solution. It's up to political leaders to lift now these geopolitical uncertainties introduced by trade tensions. So we would all welcome trade solutions. I mentioned Brexit to give another example closer to here in Washington, which is the level of investment in Canada. It suffered, we saw it in the last 2 years, from the uncertainty about NAFTA, which fortunately seems to have been resolved. But this is an important message. There are some economic policy measures to be taken, and again, you mentioned fiscal policy, structural reforms. We will come back to it. But the first answer is to lift this geopolitical uncertainty due to trade tensions. And this is clearly up to political leaders.
Mohammed.
Whatever the specificities are.
Mohammed Keshi from the Resource Group. My question, I guess, relates to something that I understand would be squarely within your wheelhouse, which is about the CFA franc, the currency of about 20-odd countries in Western Central Africa. There's been a fair bit of debate recently about the relevance of keeping the peg between the CFA franc and the euro, which of course is related to the previous peg to the French franc. the two sides to the debate being that on the one hand, there's a substantial amount of reserves that these West African countries and Central African countries maintain with the Bank of France in exchange for the guarantee of convertibility. On the other hand, the rigidities it imposes upon those countries. I just wanted to know if you had any comments given the current debate that's going on.
First, I congratulate you for your very precise knowledge of the so-called franc zone. And I guess not everybody around the table is completely aware. It's a completely free agreement with 15 African countries in Western and Central Africa, where they choose, and I stress it's their choice, to have a full convertibility of their currency. With some rules, including the centralization of part of the exchange reserve. Let me stress that it could evolve, but the rule of the game is to have chosen a regime of fixed exchange rate versus the euro and full convertibility. And it works. If you look at the results, the average growth of franc zone country compared to peers country within Africa is higher, and the inflation rate is lower. So it works. But let me stress that it's a completely free political choice. We have twice a year a franc zone meeting at ministers level. The last one was in Niger last week. And African ministers confirmed very clearly that they want to stick to this agreement for excellent economic reasons I mentioned. So I'm aware there are political polemics. Sometimes it belongs to democracy in these countries. Some of them came from European countries. I will not mention any of them, which is a bit more surprising. Let me only say that. But as long as France has no specific interest in the franc zone, we are committed to maintain it as long as it is the African interest and choice.
Thank you very much. Marcia.
Thank you. I have a question about...
Sorry, if you could just identify yourself.
Sorry, Marcia Eccles from Howard University School of Law. On your slide 8, on the right side with your three green boxes, One of them is about SMEs, which are considered a strong point in the United States and perhaps not as strong in France or in Europe as in the United States. I wondered what the role of your bank, the Bank of France, and also the European Bank will have in the scaling up of SMEs and what that really means.
First, let me perhaps precise something I said. I don't think that SMEs are underdeveloped in France or in Europe compared to the US. If you look at the demography of non-financial companies, which is always an interesting story, the number of SMEs in Europe is brilliant. It's true in Italy, it's true in Germany, it's true in France. It's also interesting to see there are differences looking at the number of large corporates. It's much smaller in Italy, it's higher in Germany and in France. And as we all know, one of the strengths of the German economy is what they call Mittelstand, so mid-size companies. But I could be very long on corporate demography, which is apparently a focus for you, but also for me. But the difference, I guess, is not the size of the companies, the difference is the financial structure. Be they small, medium-sized, or large, the level of equity in their balance sheet and compared to GDP is smaller in Europe. And this is not a French specificity, it's true for the European economy as a whole. If you try to explain that, there are probably two reasons. The first one is the company themselves, because to increase your capital, it's a very strategic decision when you are an entrepreneur. So I don't have to comment. I cannot do much thing about that. If you have a sound financial system, entrepreneurs have more contacts with diverse funding structure, including long-term funds, etc. But it's their decision. The second part of the story, which refers to the left part of the slide, is more interesting. What is the structure of savings? And here you see a significant difference between the US and Europe. The part of financial savings of American savers, which is invested in, let's say, equity products or more risky products, is much higher than in Europe. And European savers have a preference for liquid and safer assets. So here we can probably act in two ways. First, trying to foster longer term products. If you take the example of life insurance, which is very developed in France and in other European countries, it should be longer and somewhat equity oriented. And there are new products for that. And second, and this is the middle part of the slide, if you have rather liquid savings or safe savings and equity needs on the right side, you have to rely on an efficient and more developed financial system. This is precisely what the financial industry is for, to transform safe savings into longer term and riskier investments. And this is why we need to develop capital market union. Savings is sometimes in countries and the investment needs are in others. So cross-border bank consolidation, as I strongly stress, and also capital market union. And if you look at the degree of security and the time horizon, the saving is shorter, and it's up to the financial system to absorb the risk of financial transformation. We all agree about that, but we should be aware that public opinion is not completely aware of the economic purpose of the financial industry. It's sometimes a very passionate debate after the financial crisis to say that the financial industry is bad, failed, etc. We need a powerful financial industry in order to channel rather safe savings towards riskier assets in the spirit of your question. Did I answer your question? And this is part of our responsibility. The first part, to change a bit the mind of entrepreneurs and to explain to them, if you want to develop your company, if you want to invest, if you want to innovate, you need to have more equity and a bit less debt. It's up to them.
Thank you very much. Heather.
Thank you. Heather Kiriakou from Northrop Grumman. I wanted to ask a question a little bit more on trade and also following up on the previous question on SMEs. So lost in the narrative on trade often is services. In the WTO framework, services are as important as manufactured goods. And when you look at the trajectory in Western economies, especially, services are more and more important. So as we have debates within our own countries and across trade frameworks, about trade policy and its importance to GDP growth, I just wondered if you could comment from a Eurozone perspective where you see SMEs and services and policies going with trade.
Probably I couldn't agree more with your question. The most efficient way to develop growth at global level and to promote trade is to extend the domain of international agreements, especially to services. And it's a bit old style, as it is focused a bit too much on manufacturing and industry. And second, I do believe, and probably most of us around this table do believe, that international agreements, multilateral agreements, are more efficient than bilateral deals. So let us focus on the extension to services, and let us focus to multilateral agreement and what we could call the refoundation or renovation of WTO. Unfortunately, and this was maybe your question, I can only note that this is not the priority of some powerful political leaders around the table. Can I stop here?
You can on that diplomatic note.
And perhaps to add your point about SMEs, it's very important that we find ways, and it's not only due to multilateral agreements, it's also due to cooperation between large corporates and SMEs, but to involve SMEs in this international game. If we give the impression that international trade is only for large corporates, and even some very powerful companies which take the vast majority of the benefits of international trade, we will have an economic and political problem.
Thank you. Usman.
It's also the issue, sorry to add, it's also the issue of fair taxation, obviously. It's part of this international rule we need. And you know it's a strong priority not only of France, but of OECD at present.
Usman Ahmed with PayPal. In your previous speeches, you've highlighted the importance of cybersecurity as the financial sector digitalizes or becomes digitized. And you've highlighted the importance of international cooperation on that. So we know President Macron has kind of, you know, put up his initiative for international cooperation around that issue. I'm curious, from your perspective, what you've seen in the financial sector that's been interesting or exciting or on the horizon for how we can do more international cooperation around cybersecurity and if the private sector can play a role in that.
This is also a very important question. I could be very long on that, but let me try to put the answer in a nutshell. First, cybersecurity is a growing priority. We all agree on that. It will be a priority of the French G7 presidency, which we have this year. Second, there is a more powerful move, which is a welcome move, which I mentioned earlier, of digitalization of financial services with the incumbents, but with new entrants, fintechs, and also very powerful new players like your company, obviously. And this will bring us probably to new questions. There is a classical answer, which is part of the right answer, to say same activity, same financial regulation. So whatever your origin is, you are a fintech, you are a big tech, you are a financial incumbent, you will have to implement the same financial regulation. Fine enough. We will do it. Have no doubt about that. But it's only part of the answer, and I would add a second layer, because the digitalization brings probably new questions to the financial industry. Can I mention three of them? First is cybersecurity, which you mentioned, which is a new issue. Second is data protection, because we all know that, especially in payment services, we are in data collection is probably the main value, more than fees. And third is, in some issues, competition and antitrust, because we know that for some players, the winners takes most or the winners take all because of the network effects. And in this free field I just mentioned, international cooperation is less developed than for classical financial regulation. So the industry will have to adapt and providing new services with all its benefits to SMEs and households. But the regulators will also have to adapt and increase their international cooperation in these three fields, cybersecurity, data protection, and antitrust. As a matter of fact, we organized in the framework of our G7 presidency a conference on competition and financial services last Monday in the Banque de France. So we are precisely in this issue. But it's a start of a very important role.
Thank you very much. We're really having a battle with the clock at this point. So what I'm going to do is just take the questions together. So Carol and then Michael, if you could just ask your questions very quickly and then see if we can bundle in one answer. John, I think you've taken yours down. Okay.
Carol Anderson with AT&T. Following up on, I think, Heather's question and the comment that was made about digital taxation, I know France recently enacted a digital services tax of about 3% on companies with global revenues of in excess of something like $85 million, retroactive to January. Poland is looking at doing something similar. Austria is now looking at doing something similar. In parallel, the OECD task force is looking to make recommendations to the G20. So I wanted to ask you about your thoughts on these fragmented approaches to addressing perceived digital taxation issues and how that fits in with the OECD process and your support of the OECD process for sort of a universal and consistent recommendation on digital services taxes.
And Michael, if you could just ask your question quickly.
Michael Masetic, PBS Online News Hour. The European political leaders are making a big fuss in the last couple of weeks about their evolving relationship with China. To what extent are the central bank relationships with the Bank of China evolving, particularly in view of the fact that they don't have the kind of independence from political authorities that other central banks do, that you've emphasized in your discussions?
Two quite different questions.
About the first question, I am fortunate enough not to be in charge of taxation, which is always a very passionate debate. So I should have refrained from mentioning fair taxation in answer to your neighbor's question. But let me only say, as an observer, that I'm not sure there is a contradiction or a fragmentation, as you said. Some countries, including UK, introduce a domestic taxation, but in the case of France, at least, and probably for the others, they said very clearly that they would suppress this domestic taxation as soon as an OECD agreement is decided and implemented. And we all wish that an OECD solution, including the US, if I understand correctly, that an OECD agreement can come quite quickly. It was the case for international taxation of corporates with this BEPS agreement you are aware of, which was a decisive progress. So I strongly hope it can come, and it would be the definitive solution or the first best solution instead of this temporary domestic taxation implemented. But again, I'm not in charge. About your second question, it's a quite sophisticated one, no? Okay, can I say it this way? Because you mentioned the political relation with China, the technical relation with the central bank, and independence within. So I will try to think a bit on that and to elaborate. First to say that we have excellent relations with the People's Bank of China and my colleague Yi Gang. To give you only an example, but an important and not very well-known one, we took the initiative at the Banque de France 1.5 years ago to create what we call NGFS. NGFS is Network for Greening the Financial System. At the start, we were 8 central banks and supervisors. We are now 34. So it's a coalition of the willing, but a very enthusiastic one. To address the kind of recommendations supervisors and regulators could make to the financial industry in order to better prevent the climate risk. And climate risk is part of the financial long-term risk. People's Bank of China was among the founding members of this network, which is a decisive success. Yi Gang participates in our Basel meetings, which I mentioned earlier, and we have really an excellent discussion. Looking at the kind of financial policy China is implementing, obviously they had a strong development of private debt in the recent years. One of the objectives is to stabilize this level of leverage, and if possible to improve its quality, to have less shadow banking and more banking channel. They are on the way on that, and there is a delicate balance between stimulating growth, which is one of the priorities of the Chinese authorities, and addressing financial stability objectives. Looking at the independence part of the question, probably I will stop here because I'm not, you are probably a better specialist of the Chinese internal relation as you are. I can only tell that when we speak and when we work with the Chinese Central Bank, we speak with competent and fairly decisive colleagues.
Excellent. Well, that's a very good note to end on. And I'd like to thank you, Governor Villeroy, for a very comprehensive, informative, engaging conversation. And congratulations on all the work that you do, and best wishes for the future.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.